some of the depositors on various social media, on YouTube, they even reached out to us and told us, look, I like this platform better because they offer interest on fiat deposits. I struggle to understand the legal framework behind those platforms. How are they able to offer interest on fiat deposits without having a financial license, like an e-money institution license or a banking license in Europe? So can you maybe share your thoughts on this one?
We are paying interest only on cryptos. So it works like a crypto rewards for crypto balances or crypto deposits. So basically, there is only one way to pay interest on fiat deposits. And this way is to be a bank, fully regulated bank. And that works exactly the same in all jurisdictions globally. So I know that some platforms, some companies are offering interest on fiat deposits, but I think it's just completely illegal. Probably they can succeed with that being just below the radar. That means that they are small. But if they will somehow get some significant funds, I think they will go under the radars and they will get banned. They will get a lot of issues. Because basically, again, it's not legal. It's illegal to pay interest on fiat deposits without banking licenses. So
welcome back to another P2P Talk. My guest today is Ilya Volkov, the CEO of YouHodler, which is a crypto lending platform that allows you to earn interest on your crypto deposits. In today's interview, we'll be talking about some of the security features which you should consider when depositing your crypto on any crypto lending platform. So welcome to the interview, Ilya.
Yeah, thank you, Jakub. Thank you. Hi, guys.
I really appreciate you took the time to talk to me. And first, I would like to start with a short introduction of what YouHodler is offering. So perhaps you can give us like a brief intro in what kind of needs YouHodler is solving.
Yeah, sure. So basically, we are building bridges between crypto and fiat. I believe you know companies like Charles Schwab, like Revolut, like Robinhood. YouHodler is some kind of a combination of everything that comes from Charles Schwab, Revolut, and Robinhood with the opportunities that we get from blockchain and crypto. So basically, we successfully apply elements of proven traditional banking and online trading business models to crypto, to blockchain and to crypto. And, actually our mission is to integrate cryptocurrency into traditional financial system so that everyone recognizes and utilizes all the benefits of crypto as an integral part of personal financial management. So we have started the development of our platform back in 2017. The first customer was onboarded in 2018. And we have started from just one service, CryptoBack Lending. But currently we still have, of course, CryptoBack Lending on one side. On the other side, we have crypto interest accounts. And in the middle, we have a set of different trading solutions from just a pure exchange, from crypto to fiat, from fiat to crypto to crypto, and to some custom products like Multi-HODL and Turbo.
Many of our viewers and listeners of this podcast episode, they are not fully familiar with crypto lending. So can you just give us like in 1 minute, like an introduction to crypto lending? What is crypto lending?
Basically, the main idea is quite simple. So you have crypto as your favorite investment and you don't like an idea to sell this favorite investment because you believe in the future of crypto in general. So, but sometimes you need cash to pay your regular bills. It's a use case number one. Or you'd like to get more cash in order to buy more crypto. And here we have crypto-backed lending solutions that help to solve both scenarios. So you can easily use your crypto as collateral and receive fiat loan in exchange. And you can use this loan in order to buy groceries, pay your bills, or you can use this fiat to buy more crypto. So basically, here is the main idea.
And if, let's say, I want to earn interest on my crypto deposits, how does that work?
Easily. So you simply transfer your cryptos into the system and you simply get passive reward. So basically, interest on it. So speaking about YouHodler, we have interest accounts for all crypto listed on the platform. We pay on a weekly basis. We have weekly settlements and we pay with Compound. So everything is easy. Deposit your crypto to the system and receive interest. That's it.
So how do you deploy those crypto deposits in order to make sure that you pay out the interest that you promised to the depositors?
We have our portfolio very well balanced. So again, on one hand, we have crypto-backed lending solutions. On the other hand, we have interest accounts. And basically, speaking about numbers, I think it will be the best way to answer your question. So we pay up to 12% APR on crypto balances, and we earn on average from 15% annual from different crypto-backed lending products. So That works.
That's a really solid margin. I also always feel when evaluating cryptonic platforms that they are not very transparent about the way they make money. So can you just maybe give us a little bit of a sneak peek of how Euler makes money? I'm aware that you are not making money just by crypto lending products, but you also have different products, right?
Yeah, but basically everything is built around crypto-backed lending idea. So we have just a simple crypto-backed lending products where you can deposit your crypto and receive a loan, collateralized loan in fiat or in stable coins or in other cryptos. And we have custom-made products built on top of the main crypto-backed lending idea. So we have Turbocharge and we have Multi-HODL. Turbocharge allows you to buy more crypto using borrowing funds. So we execute on behalf of our customers some kind of a chain of loans in order to help him to automatically buy more crypto. So if we speak about Multi-HODL, idea is quite the same, but user interface is much more easy to use, much more friendly, much more efficient. And actually, Multi-HODL can help you to benefit from both type of market movements, like up and down. So, but in general, it works the same way like Turbocharge. So we execute chain of loans in order to buy more crypto to support our user if he or she'd like to benefit from cryptos moving up. Or we sell more crypto if our user would like to benefit from markets going down. And here is our main source of revenue, so crypto-backed lending solutions, different type of crypto-backed lending solutions. But of course, we also have our conversion service, so basically exchange, where we help people to convert fiat to crypto, crypto to crypto. And of course, we earn some part of our revenue from that service as well. So we have some minor commission on top of our exchange.
I really appreciate your transparency in this matter. I feel like there should be more transparency across the whole crypto lending industry when it comes to how the platforms make money. Obviously, another aspect is also connected to the financials of Euler as a company, right? When I was doing my initial research on Euler, I kind of did not find any financial statements publicly available. And I was chatting with the Euler support team, and your support briefed me that Euler is a private company, that you don't share any financials. But perhaps for people who are interested into depositing crypto assets on Euler in order to earn interest, they might be also interested into how Euler is doing financially as a company. So can you share some numbers?
So actually, we became profitable. We have reached our break-even back in June 2020, and we are keep growing and growing fast. So we have tens of thousands of active customers monthly. And again, we're profitable in different market conditions during bull runs, during crypto winters. So I can give an idea, like we have started in 2018. And as you remember, it was a crypto winter. But we started to get our revenues from there. Since then, we've got several periods of bull runs, and we just kept, you know, our efficiency even during, you know, bull runs. So our product portfolio is very well balanced for crypto winters and crypto bull runs. And again, we have reached our break-even back in June 2020, and now we're just growing in terms of our revenues. So as for transparency, you know, we are working hard on different licensing projects. And just in order to avoid any kind of, you know, mix in communications, we'd like to be very careful with the publishing financials. So I think we will start publishing all the details very soon based on some regulatory requirements. But until then, I just like to be very careful with any kind of, you know, miscommunications. But, you know, the main point is that we're profitable. So all good. We're growing, we're hiring, we're very stable.
Mm-hmm. I really think that this is something that, you know, also Euler needs to go forward with in terms of transparency, since there is obviously in many, not just in the crypto lending space, but also in P2P lending, there are many bad players who kind of exploit the unregulated environment and steal money from investors or potentially depositors. So I think that, you know, even Euler needs to be more transparent in this space as well. You just briefly mentioned that you are working towards regulation. So can you share with us under which regulatory framework Euler operates at the moment?
Yeah, of course. So we're currently structured based on two legal entities in Cyprus and in Switzerland. That's how we operate in the European Union and in Switzerland. So we have structured as a financial intermediary, and we also have a pawnbroker license in Switzerland. Also, now we have several projects. We're in the process of getting additional licenses in different tier one jurisdictions in Europe. So unfortunately, I cannot disclose it yet because there are some NDAs. So we'd like to move to other tier one jurisdictions and we're working hard. So first priority is still Europe. The second priority is the US. You know, we have started our preparations to enter the US market, but no, honestly, it will take, I think, like a year to complete the paperwork needed for American market. And to give an idea what our strategy is, so actually we're building, you know, customer-centric bank that supports the coexistence of crypto and fiat. We don't believe in statements like unbank yourself. You know, we believe that crypto and fiat should work together in order to unlock the full potential for the mass audience. And that's why our strategy is to build a customer-centric bank and affiliated investment firms in different jurisdictions to support the promotion and the growth of crypto-to-fiat banking services.
When I was researching U-Hodler, I found out that currently you are not accepting depositors from Germany and the US, if I'm correct. Can you perhaps share a bit of the background? Why is that? And what kind of regulations you need to follow in order to accept those users?
Yeah, so as for the US, it's really complex topics. As you know, the US is the most complicated country in the world in terms of regulation. If technically you could onboard Americans to any kind of online businesses, but if you do so, you will be at risk. And I know a lot of cases where American regulators like SEC, like CFTC, like NFA came to companies operating from abroad, and that companies got a lot of issues from American regulators. Basically, we strictly follow all regulation requirements from all countries we operate in. And we'd like to build a solid basis, we'd like to build a solid legal structure before we entering the market, if we speak about the US. And as I mentioned, we have started this process, but again, it will take around 1 year because speaking about the US, it's, you know, regulation is built on the state-by-state principle. So in order to enter the US, you need to go through different regulations in different states of the United States of America. So as for Germany, as you know, Germany implemented a year ago very actually smart regulation in regards to crypto. And in order to operate in Germany, you should have full presence. You should have domicile in Germany, should follow all requirements there. So there are some opportunities to use some kind of, you know, reverse solicitation principle, but doesn't work really well. So, and you remember I mentioned that we are in the process of getting licenses in different tier one jurisdictions. So in Germany, we have in our roadmap. And I'm sure that we will start our German operations much faster than in the United States. So it's still in progress, but we are getting some nice progress with this initiative.
I really appreciate this approach since I feel like there is a lot of platforms out there accepting everyone from all jurisdictions. And if you kind of want to look up, okay, how are they regulated? What is the jurisdiction under which they operate? Suddenly you cannot find any information anymore. And then I ask myself, okay, so I invest money on this platform and I can hope that they will not vanish with my digital assets in a couple of months, right?
Yeah, I believe, again, that crypto and fiat should work together. I believe that crypto should be properly integrated into the financial market. And there is only one way to do that. And this way is to properly and legally integrate crypto into current regulations. In some countries, it's needed to develop new regulations. So, of course, probably some companies who are following the strategy that crypto will disrupt fiat, crypto will replace fiat, and we will use in the future bitcoins instead of dollars, probably they believe that they can operate without any licenses. They believe that they can easily operate from some kind of banana islands. But I think it's just a short-term strategy. Probably they can earn something during the short period of time. But in any case, they will face a lot of issues in the future. Because again, I don't believe that crypto will replace fiat. It should be connected. Probably some companies follow the strategy like we will get some quick profits and then we will reinvest those profits into some regulated entities, et cetera, but I don't believe in this kind of approach because if you previously started some kind of a black or gray business, it will be extremely difficult to convert this gray business into completely regulated business because you will simply get a lot of questions from regulators and you will be unable to answer these questions. So again, that's why we are trying to be very careful. We are trying to be smart with entering different markets, and we follow all regulation requirements.
Mm-hmm. It sounds to me like this comes with a lot of legal fees as well. So my next question would be, are you self-funded or do you have some external investors into your holder?
We are self-funded. We are not an ICO backed. So We were always focused on efficiency, so we measure everything. We do not waste funds on some unproven, you know, techniques in marketing, again, legal. So, and being focused on efficiency, we were able to manage, you know, organic growth. Currently, we are investing our, you know, revenues, profits into the legal infrastructure, into marketing. So probably you could compare us with some other companies who have started from ICO, who raised some significant funds through ICO, like, I don't know, 50 million, 100 million, et cetera. And they simply invested significant amounts into marketing, and that is how they became visible almost immediately. So we used a different approach. We, being self-funded, we just grew organically, and we were moving step by step. Up until now, we are still self-funded at a private company with private individuals as UBOs. But actually, recently, we have started some investment relationships because, as we discussed, for example, in order to enter the US market, it's essential to build a solid legal structure, right? It's essential to hire a lot of professionals. It's essential to invest more funds in marketing to enter such a big market. And just to give you an example, so to enter the US, we need some significant investments. And that's why we decided to start investment relationships. And probably sometime in the future, in the short period of time, we will have some solid partner. The key point here is that we are not looking for just funding, because basically we can still continue our, you know, step-by-step movements, and we can still use our own funds. But we'd like to get a smart money. We'd like to get a smart investors, where additional funding will come with additional value, in terms of additional, you know, expertise, additional infrastructures, additional professionals. So, and again, so I think sometime in the future, I hope short term, mid term, we will have some solid partner onboarded to our team.
It's quite actually interesting to hear also the type of investors that you are trying to acquire in the future, and also the amount of funds that is being spent on these legal frameworks so you can fully operate in all the markets. As doing my research on cryptonic platforms, I could not really say that Uholder is less developed in terms of usability, and the mobile app works quite well. And also the services are quite advanced, in my opinion, compared to some of the other marketplaces. So it's quite interesting to see where the money will go in the future and why it's so expensive to expand.
As for the cost structure, actually, there are three main parts there. So first is all about tech. So engineers and IT infrastructure, it's a significant part of our costs. So second part is legal infrastructure. It's all about equity capital requirements for licensing. It's about legal fees for professional lawyers. And it's not something cheap. That's true. So, and the third part is marketing. The distribution between these three parts, of course, it's not equal, but it's, you know, comparable. And of course, we're speaking here about, you know, millions if we speak about annual budgets. So it's not cheap.
You mentioned that you invest also a lot of into the tech, which brings me to the next question, and that's the security of users' data. I'm aware that a lot of the cryptonic platforms have been attacked in the past, and some of the data of users has been leaked to the internet. And during my research, I came across an article about data leak on Uholder. So can you explain what has happened and what was the result of this leak?
Yeah, I guess you're asking about TechCrunch publication from June 2019.
Yes.
Yeah, it's my favorite question. Actually, it was a big PR campaign for us. We've got a huge traffic from everywhere after that TechCrunch publication. Funny point is that some media reported that it was a leak of personal data of 86 million Uholder customers. Why I'm saying funny, because we didn't have, and we still don't have, that amount of users. So I hope that we will have, you know, millions of active users sometime soon. But back in 2019 and still now, we have not a big customer base. But to be serious, what exactly happened? That event occurred because there was a refresh of our log systems, which then resulted in an error on one of our servers. So basically a test server. And that resulted in the leak. And speaking about 86 million, it was not 86 million of customers. It was 86 lines of different logs. And only 0.25% of those logs were somehow related to customer data. And there were know any sensitive data. Like some media reported that it was credit card data, including CVV codes and all that stuff. So zero sensitive data. We have fixed everything quickly after that happened. And I think the most important point is that, you know, back in 2019, we were a startup. Even now, we're still a startup. I consider ourselves more like a scale-up now, not a startup anymore, but we still have startup spirit. So, and speaking about these kind of cases, I think the most important point is how startups are reacting on these kind of challenges, on these kind of issues. How do they learn from these kind of cases? So we learned a lot. Even we didn't, you know, expose personal data, sensitive data, we learned that we should pay more and more attention on these kind of topics. So after that, we have invested a lot into our infrastructure, into security and everything. And we have started regular external pen tests. So basically, all our infrastructure, IT infrastructure, are online tested from external pen testers. You know, in general, speaking about security, so we have implemented many, many of features. So to give you some ideas, some examples, you know, we have our own system of hot, warm, cold wallets. We even have a freezer. So initially, we have built everything by ourselves because we have a really strong engineering team. But we also have added additional security features. For example, if you speak about custody, we have implemented our integration with Ledger Vault, and we're quite happy working with Ledger Vault as a trusted service provider. So we have, again, Ledger Vault integrated. On top of our contract with Ledger Vault, we have insurance. It's a pooled crime insurance for $150 million. So also, it's not, you know, disclosed yet. You are lucky, but I think I already can tell you that we are currently at the final stage of integration of Fireblocks. In addition to our own system, in addition to Ledger products, we will also have Fireblocks integrated into our platform. That will add just additional, you know, level of security for everything. And, you know, basically, we pay a lot of attention to technical part of security, and we also pay great attention to financial part of security, and that's mostly about risk management. So we don't keep all eggs in just one basket, so we have different baskets. We have enough liquidity and enough hedging reserves appropriately distributed for different type of products, different types of vaults, again. So we pay a lot of attention to that topic.
Well, it's always good to hear that, you know, security is very important. It's always good to hear that companies are spending money and building the infrastructure behind it and protecting investors' interest. That's not always the case on many platforms, be it in the crypto space or in the P2P lending area. So it's good to hear some of your thoughts on what's going on in the background. I have one last question for you. And some of the depositors on various social media, on YouTube, they even reached out to us and told us, look, I like this platform better because they offer interest on fiat deposits. I struggle to understand the legal framework behind those platforms. How are they able to offer interest on fiat deposits without having a financial license, like an e-money institution license or a banking license in Europe? So can you maybe share your thoughts on this one?
We are paying interest only on cryptos. So it works like a crypto rewards for crypto balances or crypto deposits. So basically, there is only one way to pay interest on fiat deposits. And this way is to be a bank, fully regulated bank. And that works exactly the same in all jurisdictions globally. So I know that some platforms, some companies are offering interest on fiat deposits, but I think it's just completely illegal. Probably they can succeed with that being just below the radar. That means that they are small. But if they will somehow get some significant funds, I think they will go under the radars and they will get banned. They will get a lot of issues. Because basically, again, it's not legal. It's illegal to pay interest on fiat deposits without banking licenses. So,
who is in charge of controlling those platforms? If you say at some point they might get too big and they will get under radar. So who is in charge in Europe to making sure that platforms operate legally?
Local regulators, I guess. Of course, probably there are some still crypto neutral jurisdictions somewhere in the world, but, you know, they're limited. And even operating from some, let's say, banana island, if you target customers from Europe, some of European regulators definitely will come even to Banana Island and ask their questions about how does it work, why it happened, how much funds was acquired, etc., etc. So,
to be honest, I'm not 100% sure about this one. I've seen, I've been in the P2P lending industry for a while. I've seen scams already, especially of platforms based in Ireland or Baltics. And I don't really think that the regulators are really up to date when it comes to those crypto lending platforms either. So I really hope, fingers crossed, for those people who deposit their cryptos there to be able to, you know, get them back when problems arise.
I have just one recommendation to crypto users. Do your own due diligence. So if you see that there is zero information on website, if there is no real faces of real people on website, if there is some contradictive information on the website, just be careful. Don't touch that. But if you see real legal structure, if you see real people, if you see some clear explanation of how everything works, yeah, why not? So do your own due diligence every time. It's just the only recommendation.
In the case, let's say, on interest on fiat, in the case where the platform decides to shut down their servers, to disappear, there is no protection of investors' deposits at all, right?
I guess, yes. But of course, maybe someone could manage to find some smart way to use this kind of offers only for marketing purposes. I guess probably someone could manage to play some ads saying that deposits in fiat, some ads with messaging like deposit dollars and get interest on it. But finally, if we speak about legal services, it should be converted into some other legal form. But I think there are not so many smart offers like that.
Okay, Ilya, for the viewers and listeners to this podcast episode, if you want to hear more about YouHodler, if you want to see how their services work, you can go to P2P Empire and check out our review. Ilya, thank you so much for your time. It's been very insightful. I really appreciate the honesty and transparency that you have provided today. And I hope that, you know, YouHodler is going to become even more transparent and also share some of the statistical data, since I think a lot of the investors on YouHodler would also appreciate to see some of the numbers.
Absolutely. Thank you.